My name is Lorena Hernandez.
And I'm Diana Oliva.
And today we'll be presenting the culmination of our university-based research project. Our project focused on establishing a link between estimated cognitive functioning and the prevalence of self-reported depressive symptoms. Oftentimes, those with the most creative and brilliant minds were often plagued with troubling and concerning mental health status. This has been proven throughout history. Examples such as Sylvia Plath, who was a poet and writer, and she took her own life at the age of 30. John Nash was a mathematician who struggled with schizophrenia. Abraham Lincoln, president of the United States, struggled with melancholy, which by today's standards would have been considered a clinical depression. And Isaac Newton dealt with delusions and mood swings, and some believe that he also suffered from schizophrenia. The link has been shown throughout history, and now it is time to show a link in the research.
We based our study on an article by Navarrete et al., which attempted to find a relationship between intelligence and neuroticism and how this relates to depression and other forms of psychological distress. The authors found that intelligence did increase the risk for depression across samples once neuroticism was adjusted for. And with this present study, we aim to expand on the relationship between cognitive function and depressive symptoms.
On to our research problem and purpose. Purpose of this project was to determine the relationship between cognitive functioning and the prevalence of self-reported depressive symptoms. The problem that we chose to tackle is that there is a gap in the literature concerning how cognitive function and depressive symptoms interact with young college-age adults. This age group is particularly vulnerable when it comes to depression. There is also a belief that college students have a higher level of cognitive function than their peers who do not attend the university.
The research questions for our study were, is there a relationship between cognitive functioning and self-reported depressive symptoms? Does a higher level of cognitive functioning correlate with a higher prevalence of self-reported depressive symptoms? And does a higher level of cognitive functioning correlate with a low prevalence of self-reported depressive symptoms?
The data collection methods for this study included an online survey which was administered in person via iPads to NSU undergraduate students and also via email. The survey contained Beck's Depression Inventory, which totaled 21 questions, and the MCET, which totaled 10 questions. The MCET, as shown on the left, consisted of 10 questions, which required participants to estimate certain units, amounts, speeds, etc. for the various questions. Participants were not supposed to know the exact answer, but they were supposed to give their best guess, and this would therefore measure the participants' executive functions. The Beck's Depression Inventory on the right, this is just the first 10 questions, a little sample, basically had the participants write down how true to that particular statement they most identified with. So I do not feel sad, I feel sad, I'm sad all the time, I'm so sad and unhappy, I can't stand it. These were just a sample of the questions.
We had 55 total respondents, but we only ended up using 49 after excluding some participants that were extreme outliers or they had insufficiently completed one of the portions of the survey. 78% were female while 20% were male, and we had about 2% who identified as other genders. The participants were aged 18 to 29, about half were Razor's Edge students, half were not. And here I've included some demographic data. About 56% were white, 15% Hispanic, 16% African American, and the rest are on the chart right there. For analysis, we accomplished data processing using SPSS. Numeric answers were converted into uniform units, so if they had answered in inches, we would convert it to feet. Standard deviation of each participant's MCET answer from the correct answer was found. Depression scores were also totaled.
The figure shown here is a histogram chart displaying deviation scores. Deviation scores were calculated by determining the deviation from the participant's answer to the actual answer. What is shown here is the total deviation scores for all questions put together. In essence, the smaller the deviation, the better the cognition. also just as true is how close the values are or how far they deviate from the average value. In this situation, the average value was approximately 575. The figure shown here is the distribution of depression scores for all participants in the study. Now, the most interesting thing to note about this chart is that the mean depression score was 10.67. A score of a 10.67 would land an individual participant in the moderately depressed or exhibiting moderate depressive symptoms category. And I say this is interesting because as a whole, the population scored being moderately depressed, which is definitely very eye-opening.
This pie chart displays the percentages of the sample belonging to each depressive category. Over half of the sample exhibited moderate to high depressive symptoms, which is very alarming.
The last figure we have here is our scatter plot. As seen, there is no obvious trend in the scatter plot, and this is also shown by the trend line that we've included. This indicates that there is no correlation between variables, at least not a significant one. While the general trend does not give us any significance, though, there are a couple of cases that do prove our theory. If you recall from our previous presentations, our theory was that the deviation score and the depression score would fall into a sort of U pattern. And you can't quite see it on this scatter plot because there is no pattern to be shown. But if you draw your attention over to the left, the right above the trend line, there are five dots. So pay attention to the top three dots. Now, those cases have a really low deviation score, so a high cognitive functioning, how much higher than the average. And they also have about a 15 or higher depression score, which means they fall into group three, which would be the high prevalence of depressive symptoms group. These three cases really exemplify what we thought we would find throughout the participant sample. Now, also drawing your attention over onto the right-hand side, we have what look to be outliers, but in actuality are very indicative of the other side of the U that we previously mentioned. We also mentioned that those on the lower end of the deviation score spectrum would also exhibit a high depression score, so that each of the two extremes in this case would be at risk for a high prevalence of depressive symptoms. This is shown by that single dot above the blue line all the way to the right, not the farthest one up, just the one over to the right, which exhibits a depression score of 21 or 22, but a really high deviation score, which would indicate a lot of deviation between their answers and the actual answers, and hence a lower cognitive score, especially when compared to the average. Now, remember, the average stood at around a 575, and this is shown in this graph here because most of the dots you can see center around the 400 to 800 range. But if you were to cut off and section off the deviations from this, you can clearly see that, especially with those three dots over on the outlying left and with a couple dots outlying on the right, that there is the beginnings of a U starting to form here. More participants are especially needed to see if the theory would hold out. But yeah.
In conclusion, there is no significant relationship between depressive symptoms and cognitive function, which means that we fail to reject our null hypothesis. Future studies should broaden the scope of our research and address the limitations of this study. Perhaps a larger sample and increased funding would yield more meaningful results.